Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
And welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsmen. I am Kay Bennecoff, your host. And tonight we have with us Jeffrey Fiant. And he is the, what should I call you, Jeffrey? The producer of this fine 49th annual Pennsylvania Traditional Crafts and Folk Art
Show. Well, I don't know if producer's the right term.
Producer.
I don't. Whatever.
Organizer.
Yes.
Okay.
Foolish and person. To
foolish
take
person. Yes. Okay. And then we have Janice Sonnen, who will be participating in the show, and Barry Bennecoff, both members of the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. Hello.
Hello.
Actually, we're all members of the Reading.
I know we all are. So, okay. So, Jeff, why don't you tell us how this show started?
All right. The show started back in, I'm not sure if it was 1975 or 1976. It was started by Carol and Claudia Hoff and Daniel and Barbara Strasser. They lived in Stoutsburg, and if you... You're not near old enough to remember this, but back in 1975, 1976, with the Bicentennial, there was a huge upsurge in interest in traditional crafts, and they decided it would be a neat thing to have some folks invite people into their homes, see what it was that they were producing, and have a little sale. Lester Breininger, the Redware Potter, also participated, and I think that's who it was that first time. The next year they decided to have the show again, and the show grew to six participants. It was Carol and Claudia. Claudia did scissor cutting, still does. Carol, her husband, did different types of graining on different wooden pieces. Daniel, of course, did his wood carvings. Barbara was an artist, did paintings. Lester Breininger and his wife Barbara. Lester had his redware pottery there. Tom Luce did his blacksmith and whitesmith work. There was Marge Yoder, who did theorem painting, and Tom Stauffer from Lidditz, who had his pewter there. The show was held twice a year, spring and fall. In the spring, they always held it in the church grove at the west end of Stoutsburg. And then the fall show was held in the firehouse in Stoutsburg. Did that for I'm not sure how many times. I joined the show in the early 80s, and we did it twice a year for a number of years, but we had moved the show by that point to the old schoolhouse in Stoutsburg. And finally, at some point, I don't remember dates, but we cut the show back to once a year. The show was always produced or put together by the craftspeople. We never charged admission for it. We always had free refreshments. It was always kind of a thing to... basically like you were inviting your friends into your home or to see your work, and it was never done as, you know, we're going to try and charge money at the gate and see how much money we could get. We all split the jobs that had to be done and, you know, divvied up how much we spent, and that's how much the show cost to do that here. So we had continued with the seven of us for quite a few years. And then we slowly started to add more people as we had more room at the old school. And I'm going to say maybe 15 years ago, so that would be 2000 to 2002, three, somewhere in that time frame, Stoutsburg had to use the school for other uses, a police department and the municipal offices. So at that time, we relocated the show from Stoutsburg to the South Heidelberg Township Municipal Building behind Warnersville. And we had it there. That was the old Green Terrace Elementary School. It's kind of ironic. That's where I went to elementary school at. We had the show there for approximately 10 years, I believe it was, when South Heidelberg decided that they were going to sell the building and relocate the municipal building. The building was sold to Karen Foundation, and so we needed another home for the show, and it was at that point that we moved it to where it's located presently, which is at Allegheny Evangelical Lutheran Church in Nowers. We've been having the show there since then. It's been a great location for us. We, of course, have more space, and it's a bright facility. It just lends itself to having a show there much more. We also have a kitchen there, so the youth group typically has a stand there where they can sell refreshments and things, and that benefits their mission trip that they do every year.
Which is very nice.
Which is always a good thing to support.
Absolutely. So in this event, you have, it's traditional crafts.
Correct.
There. And by that definition, that is?
Well, we've always, the show is called Pennsylvania Traditional Crafts and Folk Art. So we're looking for craftspeople that are doing things that would have been done in the 18th and early 19th century in Pennsylvania. We like things that are native to this area. So that's pretty much what you'll find at the show. We've brought different things in through the years, but that's always been a focus for us, was to have it be those traditional crafts.
Right. So everything that was, at one time, I always say that everything that is traditional now, though, was once contemporary when it was first incepted, right?
Sure.
You know, and
yep.
So that's how it keeps evolving, okay, you know. So we have you, Jeff, do Windsor chairs.
Correct.
Okay. And Janice here is
hooked and penny rugs.
Yes, and that's mostly done with wool, is
that
correct?
It's done with 100% wool.
Mm-hmm.
It came into Pennsylvania from the New England states, and I think it first started in Canada and came down through the states.
Mm-hmm.
But my husband's grandmother did it early on, mm-hmm. and so it's been a craft that has been around for a long time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then Barry down there is a furniture maker, more in the traditional, I mean traditional meaning the
traditional primitive styling.
Yeah, okay. So we had gathered, we have several, well, all members of Reading Berks Guild,
mm-hmm.
and Reading Berks Guild is traditionally known as a traditional guild, but
using
we
that
have...
word too often.
I use that word too often, yes. Okay, but Reading Berks definitely has contemporary craftsmen and artists in, you know, so the guild is multifaceted, shall mm-hmm. we say. But at the Kutztown Folk Festival this year, we gathered several of the craftspeople who will be showing at this show. And it would be a good time to cut to that now, Jeff.
Sure,
and
that would
and we'll
be a great, great thing.
Okay, and then we'll come back and talk to us. So,
okay.
Yeah, so take it away, cameraman.
Well, hello. Look, I'm here at the Kutztown Folk Festival with a few people that I know, the traditional craftsmen here from the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen, and I gathered them all here today, and then there's an array of their crafts here, and I'm going to have you, we're going to speak to each and every one of them here. So let's start back here with, we're at the booth of Fedge, known as Jeffrey Fiant, but his real name is Fedge.
Uh-huh. Good morning, Kay. Thanks for stopping by. The folks that are gathered here, we're all participating in the Pennsylvania Traditional Crafts and Folk Art Show, which is held on October 21st this year at Allegheny Evangelical Lutheran Church. It's a show that's been going on for quite a few years. It was started in 1976, so we're approaching this is our 49th show this year, as we had it
held it twice a year for a number of years, but that's what all the folks here are going to be gathering at that show, and we just thought we'd give you a little preview of what's there.
Well, that's so awesome. Yes, here at the Kutztown Folk Festival, we have a nice array of traditional and contemporary crafts, and even the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen has that too. But your show that you will be, you know, hosting then, you know, in a couple of months will be strictly traditional crafts.
Correct. We've always tried to keep it as traditional as we possibly could, with Pennsylvania crafts as the one of the criteria. Things that you would have found in Pennsylvania in the 18th and 19th century.
Yes, and we love it. So we're going to start, I'm going to run right over there to Deborah, okay? And we're going to talk about the beautiful basket that she has in front of her. Okay, so here we go. How are you doing, Deb?
I'm doing good today.
Okay, and you have just finished this beautiful basket. And tell us about the weave on that and anything else we need to know.
Well, this is a basket that, in addition to being utilitarian, has a decorative weave added, which kind of speaks of Native Americans. The Native Americans did really interesting things on their baskets, so I have added some of them to my traditional baskets. Also work with some pine needles, but have a lot of egg baskets, laundry baskets, really traditional utilitarian mm-hmm. things.
You said something very interesting. You said pine needles in the basket. Okay, can we hold that one up there and see if we can get a good shot on this? Do you want to hold that one up for us, Deb? Okay, and tell us about pine needles in the weave.
Well, pine needles are used in a technique that's called coiling, where you're actually stitching bundle upon bundle, building row by row. And for me, it was a place I went after some of the more traditional baskets. It's a very old art and craft form, but it combines basketry and sewing, which were two things I did previously.
Yeah, that's wonderful, so beautiful. Okay, thank you for that, Deb. Mm-hmm. Oh, and here's, we found another Deb. Okay, and Deb does very interesting art form over there. Where is yours? Okay, up there is the Santa with the pig there. And tell us about that, Deb. I'm not even going to tell them until you talk.
Well, all of my work is fabric, and it's filled with sawdust. I had to clear my throat. And it's filled with sawdust. I designed the pattern, cut it out of fabric, sew it up, leave a tiny opening, and fill it with sawdust, and stitch it shut and paint it. A lot of my designs are Pennsylvania German. I don't know why I chose this one exactly, but...
Well, everyone loves when Santa comes, right?
Well, the thing is that this week at the festival, I'm stuffing pigs.
Oh, okay. So. Well, that's appropriate. There's a lot of pigs around this festival here, you know.
But anyway, so... stop laughing at me.
You know, no. There's laughing at this table, okay?
So where was I? Anyway, you know.
Because you're stuffing pigs.
I'm stuffing pigs. But yes, it's a traditional craft. They used whatever materials were available to them to stuff their toys and dolls.
Mm-hmm, yes, but you've taken the craft to a new height, okay, right? You know, because like you said, it was definitely dolls. And mm-hmm. what else did they use that for? I mean...
Pin cushions. Tailoring hams, mm-hmm. What else? Oh, the bobbin lace, when they made bobbin lace, all of those things were filled with sawdust. Mm-hmm. So it was readily available and something that they used for a lot of different things. They use it in the ice house. I mean, sawdust.
Yeah.
And I'm always getting people coming into my booth and, do you need any sawdust? Well, usually it means that the wives went me to come and clean up their
husband's shops.
Yes.
My husband cleans his own shop and brings you the sawdust.
I know, he brings me the sawdust. So
very good.
His is nice and clean. It's very yes. clean sawdust.
Good. Okay, well that's beautiful. And again, you know, Deb has a lot of different ideas that she has done, as she said, in the Pennsylvania Dutch tradition. So when you stop...
More birds. Mm-hmm.
That come from like the hex sign design?
Fractors and fractors. Yes. Yeah, some people call my work three-dimensional fractor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I can understand why. Okay. And back here we have the potter. Okay. Hi, Kurt. How are you?
How you doing?
You didn't mind that I did that, right?
Nope. You get used to it after a couple days. Yeah, it's kind of a habit out here at the Kutztown Folk Festival, right? Okay, and so there is Kurt's. You want to talk about your pottery, Kurt? You have a good history with that.
Okay, I do traditional Pennsylvania redware. It's the color of the clay that you would find in the ground in this area. And what I brought today was a patriotic crock that I did. And just with a little bit of flair, we put handles on the side just to kind of make it our own design.
Mm-hmm. And the clay, do you get it yourself then? I mean, you said that it's indigenous to here or not?
No, we go through a lot of clay that just the purification of the clay takes so long. Right. We can't dig everything that we need. Mm-hmm. So we actually get our clay right out of Harrisburg here.
Okay, so it is from, yeah, okay. And but you have done some things that you've dug your own clay and, you know, just.
Yeah, we dig our own clay around the area with some things. We made a couple of reproductions for like the Kahnweiser Historical Site, mm-hmm. so they could use it in their shop. And anywhere we can find it, if farmers have it, we ask. And
yeah, that's awesome.
It's fun. It's a long process.
I'm sure, yes. But done in the traditional way, then.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But not that your other, you know, when you get the clay, it's all ready for you, so it's still done in the traditional way. You fire everything?
Yep. We fire twice with our kilns. Mm-hmm. So we make sure you burn all the impurities out the first firing, and then the second firing is more for the colors and the glazes. Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Okay, and you will see Kurt at that show as well. Okay, but come visit us here at the Kutztown Folk Festival. Bob, spelled Bob, B-O-B-B-O-B, right?
Yep. Forwards or backwards.
Yes.
It's still Bob.
Yeah. Yep. And you do know that which way you're coming and going.
I don't know for sure.
That's true.
It's hard to tell. At any given time, it's very hard to tell. I'm a shaker box maker. The shaker boxes were over there on the table, and they're beautifully grain painted. My wife, Debbie Jarrett here, she grain paints these boxes for me, and they're very beautiful, and they're utilitarian. They were used by the shaker community to hold all manner of items for the sewing shops or the workshops, and the men's would hold the tacks and pegs, wooden pegs and wooden parts and pieces in them. They were used in the kitchens for culinary dry goods, and so they're very useful. And a big question that a lot of customers ask us is, what do you put in them? And my standard answer is, well, what do you have? And, you know, because you could put your $20 bills in there or bars of soap or anything. I mean, they're great. They're just empty vessels that you can just use them for looking nice. Mm-hmm. So that's...
But they're all stacked, so they come in different sizes. Was there any reason for that, why they were made like that? You know, why this, were they made for certain things? You know, did the shakers have certain things in mind, do you think?
Well, yes and no. I mean, you know, again, that lends back to the, what did they have? Well, mm-hmm. you know, they had, in the kitchens, they had dry goods, mm-hmm. and so they would use them for, you know, salt, pepper, flour, sugar, herbs, yeah. And so, you know, they might not have enough herbs for a bigger box, so a smaller one fit well.
Okay.
And the same way, that applies for the men's workshops or the sewing shops of the ladies, that, mm-hmm. You know, they might not have so many buttons, so they would have a smaller button box. But they were well thought out.
Yes.
You know, by the Shaker people to accommodate all their needs. They made these boxes in different sizes to accommodate whatever needs they had.
Right, because they were plain folks. They only used what they needed, you know, made what they needed. You know, it wasn't,
right.
you know.
That's right. That's right. They made those items for exactly what they needed.
Purposeful. Yep. Yes, yep. Yes. Okay, thank you so much.
That they're used primarily to keep money in.
The larger ones.
Oh, okay. Yeah, he said $20 bills, but he meant something bigger.
Right, right? I okay. do believe
Does
that, yes.
Does he make those out of cypress or something so they don't rot when he buries them?
Okay, we love you, Bob. We're going to go over here to Hiram. I mean, why do I keep calling you Hiram? I don't know. Okay, and this is, his real name is Michael. We have this standing joke, right? Yes. You know, so I'm sorry, but yes, I have Sally. To do that too. Okay. Okay, this is Michael Brown, and Mike's going to tell us about...
Paper mache.
Tell us about paper mache.
Pieces out of paper mache, and paper mache dates back to the Washington era. Actually, Washington ordered paper mache for his medallions in his home in Mount Vernon. But it actually comes from the French word for chewed paper. I don't chew the paper, though. I get someone else to chew.
Does Donna chew the paper? I'm just no.
No.
Oh, outsiders. Okay. Okay. So, I don't even know what to say about that. Chewing tobacco, chewing paper.
Contest.
Okay.
Yeah.
That sounds like fun.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a fun thing.
Is
yes.
there any spitting with that?
No.
No.
No
spitting.
No. No. So again, Pennsylvania Germans used to mold the paper mache, and they called it chalkware.
Oh, okay, that's interesting. So they made molds and pushed
they
used
to take old candy molds.
Okay.
I mean, the Germans started chalkware. They used to take plaster and put it in religious molds, and being plaster would leave a mark when you scratched it. They call it chalkware. Mm-hmm. Pennsylvania Germans molded the same thing, but you molded paper mache and called it chalkware.
So your art form goes back?
Way back to the Chinese, actually.
I was going to say, Chinese did a lot.
They paper, you know, so
yes,
goes
did.
Way back to that, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Back
yeah.
to the 1300s, yes.
Yeah, yep. yeah. So that is the Uncle Sam, then, that you
Uncle
did
Sam,
here.
Yes.
Yeah, so yep. appropriate for the day after.
Yes,
the
it is.
Of July. Yeah. The whole week,
He's
right?
He's resting from yesterday.
Resting from
yes.
yesterday.
Yes.
Okay, and so you'll be able to see Michael there and come out to the Folk Festival and see him right here. He has a lot of other things other than Uncle Sam.
Yes.
You do
all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
All kinds, all seasons.
Halloween is your favorite.
Halloween's the biggest seller at the festival, actually.
Oh, just about anywhere, right? You know.
About anywhere Halloween goes. Very big,
yeah.
yes.
Yeah, yep. Everyone loves pumpkins and witches and goblins.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
Hiram. Okay, now we're back to... What was that? Fetch?
No. What am I going to fetch?
Fedge. How do you spell that?
F-F-E-J.
Oh, okay. I just wasn't sure. So all these beautiful chairs that everyone is sitting on are done by the Mr. Jeffrey Fiant.
Yes, they are. I've been building chairs since, it's 40 years now.
Really? And you're only 35.
It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. But yeah, it just seems like yesterday. No, I started building chairs when I was in high school. And so 40 years ago it was. And I've been doing the festival here. This is year 36, I believe. So
wow.
Been a long time.
That's impressive.
Yep.
So the different styles, mostly Windsor back? Is
well,
that what
Windsor
you,
chairs
all Windsor
I have
chairs.
Here. Mm-hmm. Most of the chairs I have here have a Philadelphia, Pennsylvania background. I have one or two New England pieces, but I like to work with the Pennsylvania designs.
Okay. And then people can come and just order the chairs
yeah,
here,
I don't
right?
have
How long does that usually take you to make a chair?
Well, right now it seems delivery is, you know, a year to a year and a half mm-hmm. for orders that I have, and it keeps me busy. It's not my full-time job anymore, so it's a profitable hobby right now.
There you go, and a very beautiful one.
Thanks. I enjoy it.
Yeah, well, we enjoy it too. And last but not least here, we're going to come over to, Barry. Yeah, Barry. Barry Bennecoff.
It's weird that you can remember my name.
Yeah, we're married.
Okay. I'm a furniture maker, I'm a Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen, and I'm been involved, fortunately, with this group of people for a short time. And and it's been quite a learning experience. And a lot of this traditional stuff that you're going to see at the show in Nowers is well, it's not just a show, it's also a sale.
Yes.
It is going to be quite amazing to everyone because it's more than just the group we have here. I mean, it's around 20 people, isn't it, Jeff? 18 to 20, depending what goes on that weekend, but it's an awesome event.
Again, working in the traditional style, so anyone totally interested in that will love coming to this small show, which, you know, is very, very nice.
Yes, you know, I brought a table down here today.
Barry has a table over here that he made under the shaker boxes, right?
Yes, yes, I'm holding up the boxes for Bob, you know, so they don't shake too much.
Okay. So. Well, I think that's the start of the festival, so we're going to all run you back to your booths. And like I said, thanks, guys, for all coming out here and gathering with us today, okay?
Okay. Well, that kind of gave us a good look at who's going to be at the show, right? You know, mm-hmm. And we have several more people. But that brought to mind a question that I have for you, Jeffrey. When you talked about your Windsor chairs, okay, mm-hmm. You said that you do them in the Pennsylvania style.
Correct.
But you do a few in the New England style. Mm-hmm. So now I have that question for you. What is the difference?
Well, one of the biggest differences, this particular chair that I brought with tonight is a Lancaster County style chair. It's a Lancaster County sackback. And one of the most obvious things is the turning style that's used in the legs and the stretchers and the arm stumps. This was a style that was unique for Lancaster County, where they did a different type of turning in the front versus a blunt arrow type turning. But the turning in the rear leg is more of a ring and vase type turning. Yeah. So it was just a quirk that was unique to Lancaster County, and I like to promote that. To me, it just has a little bit more of a unique character.
More character. So was the New England style, is that more a plain?
Well, the New England chairs typically were a little bit daintier than the Pennsylvania chairs. I guess Pennsylvania people had too much schleck and needed a little bit broader seat.
Do we?
But the New England chairs were typically a little bit daintier. The turnings might have been a lot more pronounced, but the thinner at spots, more delicate looking, I think, is the best way to
describe that.
Yeah.
So that probably a person would really have to have studied that, or you know, been in tune to decorating in that mm-hmm. style to notice that small difference. So blame that on scrapple and shoe fly pie. Okay, so that we needed the sturdier chair on that. You know?
Well, the Philadelphia chairs. Typically, a lot of them had a very large D-shaped seat. The D-shaped seat was early Pennsylvania. This is the oval-shaped seat, which again originated in Pennsylvania. Seat shapes, New England used more shield shape. They did start using some oval shapes, but this was a good early Pennsylvania design.
Okay, so speaking in the traditional style, this is when you sit in one of these chairs, though, they are so comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
And that started way back, and it is still today so comfortable. You can sit and work your laptop in that chair and feel as good as when you're sitting on one of those rolly things, you know, that we find in our offices today.
Well, I think if you look back in the history of Windsor chairs, before the Windsor became popular, all your chairs, the back was at a right angle to the seat.
Mm-hmm.
So they made a Windsor. It's basically a stick chair. And that's a good picture on the screen because it shows how all the pieces come together and are joined in the seat.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're doing things, the legs are independent of the back of the chair. So now we can do something with angles. We can angle the legs, we can give the legs splay so it's sturdy. It makes it harder to tip over. And now we can angle the back a little bit. We can put the spindles in at an angle and that you can sit back in it and you can be more comfortable. And if you also look at the seat is scooped out and shaped almost like a saddle effect, which the contours are there, and it just makes it much more comfortable to sit on than a flat board.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Have you ever made a rocker? When I look at a Windsor chair, I think of the scene in The Patriot when he's trying to get the rungs correct and he picks up the whole chair and I go, oh, he just threw that chair and it all fell to pieces.
Well, I can proudly say that I've never had that experience. I do remember one time I put some wedges in the legs coming through the seat perpendicular with the grain, which you can't do, and I did
throw
that out the door into the field because that made some a lot of scrap really quickly. But the chairs really hold up well.
The line going around the seat.
Mm-hmm.
Did I read somewhere that there's something about that line? Is it?
It's called a rain gutter.
Okay.
And you know, I've actually been out in the rain with these a couple of times, and it does work, but I wouldn't recommend that. Windsors were originally used in this country as garden furniture, believe it or not.
Oh, wow.
And if you would go down to Mount Vernon, George Washington's home, if you look across the front piazza, there's 24 combbacks that are across the front overlooking the river, so there's a lot of history with using them outside. And I know Thomas Jefferson's property, they have some sitting outside as well.
Cool. Yeah.
Most people today.
We won't put ours there.
No, I know.
Yeah.
But
no.
I've made one, so I know that all the work that goes into it, no, I'm not having it outside.
Occasionally I do sell chairs, it seems settees, where people are putting them on a covered porch.
A covered porch, yeah.
Okay, a covered porch.
I would still be concerned about it getting legs and
well, was there a certain, when they were first made, what kind of paint did they use that they could put it outside?
Well, they were typically painted. This was more of a common man's chair. Mm-hmm. And they mixed their own paint at that point in time. So it was an oil-based paint, a linseed oil-based paint. There was probably lead in it, so the paint held up really well outdoors. Now, they did use milk paint as well. Mm-hmm. That was used in different areas, but it did hold up.
And is there a certain name for the end of your...
The knuckle arm.
The knuckle arm.
Yeah, that's the carved knuckle. A lot of people think that's a good stress reliever to run your fingers through that, but that's...
A lot of the early paints had egg whites put in them also to make them stronger.
Okay.
If you ever worked on something that has egg white in the paint, you're going to struggle to get it off.
You know how hard it is to get it
and
off.
If you get hungry, you can always chew on it.
Yeah. Yeah. Janice, let's talk about your traditional craft there. Okay, we touched on it a little bit.
Yeah, I have two different ones. The wool hooked rugs, they're done on a base cloth with strips of wool. I first do a pattern on paper, and then I transfer it to the base cloth, which could be monk's cloth or linen. And you have a hook and you start bringing the loops in the rug up. I first put the design on the rug and then I fill in the background. The second one I have here is called a penny rug. And they used to call these penny rugs because back when they were made around the 1850, they would use a penny as their
pattern.
And pennies were about that size.
They were big.
They were big, they were heavy, and they bought a whole lot. Today, I use all different size circles. I still cut all my circles out by hand. And I have to give credit to my husband because he makes a lot of the kits. And he'll sit and cut out circles for me. The stitching around the penny rug is just a common stitch called the blanket stitch. I have little French knots in the center of these. I always feel like the artistic being with these rugs is the coloring that you use. I named this one for the fall, and I called it Pumpkin and Spice because of the colors in it. And it's connected pennies. A lot of times I use a base cloth and sew the pennies directly onto the base cloth. But this one, all the pennies are connected.
And this is like a very traditional motif. If you look back over the years, mm-hmm. you would right. find this.
And rugs, especially for the penny rugs, back then it was spelled R-U-G-G, and nobody knows when it was meant for the floor. Uh-huh. Most of these, not the hooked rugs, but the penny rugs were made for tables and for chairs. The hooked rugs, women started making them with feed sacks as their base cloth mm-hmm. and any kind of serviceable material that they had. Mm-hmm.
Now, were feed sacks made of wool or were...
I think it was, don't quote me on this because but it was between 1850, 1860 that burlap came into being.
Okay.
And their feet came in those bags mm-hmm. and that's when they started using burlap. But over the years, burlap deteriorates. And so that's why today I hardly ever use burlap, mm-hmm. Unless somebody comes to me and says, mm-hmm. would I use their old aunt's? And I did once. This woman came to me and her aunt had started a rug and it was on burlap. But because of all the years that it was folded, as I got closer to the edge, the burlap started to deteriorate.
Yeah.
And so I had to reinforce that before I could finish mm-hmm. it.
It's such a loose weave in burlap.
And it's irregular, whereas if you're using monk's cloth or primitive linen, the holes that you bring the strips of wool through mm-hmm. are a little bit more even. Mm-hmm.
So at this show, you'll be doing some of this a little bit in your booth, right? And so I think people get fascinated by seeing you do
right.
it because, it's something that they could do themselves,
That's right, and especially penny rugs.
Yeah.
I tell people that you put the circles in baggies, and no matter where you're going, if you have to sit in a doctor's office, you can sew mm-hmm. a couple pennies together.
Yeah.
It's very compatible with moving... hooked rugs, not so much.
Mm-hmm.
You have to
sure.
kind of be at a frame.
Yeah.
Now, Janice, I'm sure that you have done this. How many pieces of wool? I'm sure you've counted that.
No.
Not a clue.
Not a clue.
Thousands.
Yes, it would be like counting the hairs on your head.
Okay.
Well, not on Jeffrey's. So, also, recycling enters into this.
That's
craft
right, and a lot of rug hookers will recycle. They'll go to the secondhand stores and buy the wool skirts, wool blazers. Mm-hmm. Some of them will take it home and over dye those pieces so they get the colors that they want. I don't usually use the secondhand wool. My wool is bought new, mm-hmm. and I wash it and bring the fibers together and then strip it. And I don't strip it by hand. I strip it by a little machine that I have.
Oh, okay. You mean
yep.
when you say strip it, you mean
yep.
cutting it into
you
your
have,
piece,
yep.
your
mm-hmm.
pieces. You were talking about a process that some people might be interested in, though, that you said that you wash your wool.
And that's called felting.
Felting, okay. And what does that do to...
I wash it in very hot water, and then I actually throw it in the dryer. Some people hang it on the line, but washing it in that hot water and some detergent, I don't use a full amount of detergent, it brings those fibers closer together. And if you're buying secondhand wool like that, look for a tightly woven mm-hmm. wool. If you buy something that's really loose, you're not going to be happy with it at
yeah.
all.
Mm-hmm. I can remember my grandmother had a woolen jumper, and she felted it, not knowingly. And so when she brought it over to her house, my grandmother was about a size 10, about 5'2", and the jumper became about this big.
Right.
You know, and the zipper just went, So there she was, way ahead of her time, or behind her time, whatever.
Right. You know, you talk about everything is green today and you recycle. Think back, I know my grandmother made some braided rugs out of wool, but that was after the clothing was totally worn out.
Sure.
You know, it passed through, I don't know how many people wore the clothing, and then the last thing that you could possibly do with it was take it and make braided rugs.
My mother-in-law told me the story that when my husband's sister was little, she had this bright red coat, and Malcolm's grandmother braided rugs, and she couldn't wait until she outgrew that red rug, red coat, so she could put it in one of her rugs.
That's a good story. Yeah. So, and yeah, so it's all lovely, and here again, you know, very interesting for people to come and talk to you about this and something that you can.
And I think traditional to me means made by hand, that it's something that people enjoy doing and making, and I think the Folk Art Show is really a good show to demonstrate that, because I think there's nothing like a handmade piece of craft that you know, and you know the people.
And even it has character.
Even in a contemporary home, okay, you know, that one piece, you know, whether it's a chair, a piece of furniture, a rug, piece of pottery, you know, a toll-painted object or something. Mm-hmm. It's just, you don't have to have your whole house, you know. You don't have to be, you know, not like me. I mean, I want my, I want everything to be traditional in my house, but that doesn't mean that that's what it has to be, you know, except in my house where I have my furniture maker down there.
How lucky are you?
Yeah. Well, that's how he got started, right, Barry?
You don't have the washboard and...
No, I don't want the washboard. I'm not that traditional. I have that hanging in my laundry room, but I have to say I do not use
them. We like our conveniences.
Yes, we do.
Yes.
I like them hidden.
You don't cook in the fireplace or anything like that.
I'm sorry?
You don't cook in the fireplace
or anything
like that.
No. Okay. But I do have the cooking tools.
Well, it kind of brings to mind of a simpler time. We like to think of it as simpler. You didn't deal with all the electronic things, but you know, people worked really hard in the 19th century.
They did.
You know, it was a 7-day-a-week survival. Mm-hmm. You know, yes, you took some time off on Sunday. To worship, but it was a tough time.
Yes, it was.
But we like to think of it as a simpler time, and because you didn't have all the distractions that we seem to have in the world today. Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go back to the good old days, turn off the air conditioning.
Yeah, and that's how I was going to say, and that's how Barry got started, because I had this love of colonial. And I think I gained that in 1976, you know, when Barry and I were first married, and I, you know, were looking at building our house and everything, and it was like I couldn't get past the colonial look. And then that's when Barry said, okay, he says, I can do that. So, and
that was after you bought the first dining room set.
Yeah, you know, and he said, I can do that.
Blinds are very simple, and I've been doing woodworking all my life, so it was not a big deal to make some of these things. And the products, most people, they'll ask you about, like Jeffrey's chairs are made out of oak and poplar and different things, maple, all that kind of stuff. Yeah, okay, on the chairs, you need that for the strength because of the size of the material that's being used. Most primitive furniture was made out of pine and poplar because the hardwoods were used for shelter and machinery. And people don't realize, they think there was always metal machinery and things like that, you know.
Think back.
But no, you know, bridges had to be built and things like that. And just like the grist mills and all that, there's a lot of wooden parts inside them. And that's what the hardwoods are used for. And the pine furniture, I mean, that was a big thing in colonial times. Mm-hmm. So,
Yeah, that's for sure.
And we've been working on it for over 30 years now, and the time I've had, like with doing with this traditional show and with the Reading Berks Guild with their shows and the folk festival at Kutztown, I've learned a lot from a lot of the people that I've dealt with, and a lot of people come in and we go through the whole process of how things are made and the traditional things that we do when we're building them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and a lot of handwork goes into
a
it.
A lot of, yeah.
You know, and that's just a good thing to get all that explained.
I know in our house, we have a lot of handmade furniture and different accessory pieces, and I get a lot of pleasure from knowing the people that made it.
Yes.
And all the the work that went into it.
Mm-hmm.
It really means a lot to me.
Mm-hmm.
And some people say that might be cluttered there, but you have too many things, but you know, each piece tells a story.
Mm-hmm. Well, Kay and I got into a habit of some of the older artists, we will like to buy a piece of their work, because you don't know how long they're going to be around making these things, you know?
Mm-hmm.
They just disappear one day. I mean, over the years that I've been involved, is Bill Leinbach, you know? I mean, you hardly ever see Bill anymore. And
he's still around, though.
Yes.
And he's,
Ned
Foles, he's weaving.
You know, and different people like that that, you know, were involved from the early days in the craft thing, and they're just, you know, not around anymore.
Yeah.
But they're out there all the time, so.
And you appreciate their things.
You appreciate their work.
And it's like Jeff was saying too. It's like you're surrounded by your friends, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how craftspeople feel, you know. When someone buys a piece from them, I mean, it is like giving a little bit of your soul to them, you know.
It truly
is. Yeah.
We all have our groupies too.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, we do.
You know, they show up at all your shows.
Yeah.
But so that reminds me of a woman. She came to take a rug hooking class from me. And before she left, she said to me, "It must be nice to have a home full of handmade items."
Mm-hmm.
But again, we've been collecting for so long that...
So we hope that you know, you come out and you can find that one special piece that may, you know, just sing to you, you know. But we have some other guests that, I mean, other artists that will be there that we can talk about. We have a little picture down here done in the very traditional folk art painting by Wendy Clayton.
Mm-hmm.
And where's Wendy from? She is
from New Jersey.
From New Jersey. Right, okay.
This will be Wendy's first year at the show.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And she's a newly juried member of the Reading Berks Guild. And we have other people, Lynn Taylor. She is a beauty, does beautiful porcelain.
Yeah, it's a Delft pottery, a blue and white pottery.
Yeah.
Her and artwork is magnificent.
Yeah. She does like her own mixture. It's called kaolin. You know, the clay comes
clay
from
mix.
Her own property.
Oh, really?
You know, yes. Okay. From her business is called Kingston Pottery. So she will be there. And Joan Dunham is a theorem artist.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have any kind of sample of that, but theorem is...
painting on velvet.
Yes. And it's like a stencil. So Joan cuts her own stencils and creates these beautiful pictures of, we would call some of them still lives, animals.
Yeah, she does animals and birds and flowers.
Mm-hmm. I love her rabbits.
Oh, her rabbits are so much fun.
Yeah. And then we have the team of Pat and Ray Oxenford.
Sure.
Okay. And
you should hold up Pat's book.
Yes, I have Pat's book here. Okay. She actually, this is probably her first book. I think she's done another book as well. But they're a good team, husband and wife team. Like Ray creates the tin pieces, and Pat paints on them in what they call the toll painting, which toll is French for sheet iron, and so that's where that comes from.
Okay, Ray also creates wooden pieces that she paints on, like the bride's boxes.
And that is
like
her second book. You know, she did a book on bride's boxes, you know. And then we have another husband and wife team, too, Ken and Carolyn Handwork.
Mm-hmm.
And they do tin as well, but more
different
tin lighting.
Correct.
You know, they do a lot of the colonial lighting, you know, pieces and trays too, and mm-hmm. things like that, you know, but that is like the, you know, the tinsmith.
Yeah, that's what probably what more people think of with tin work. Is, mm-hmm. It's a, you know, the shiny tin.
And how about
tin.
The carver that is coming, Bastian?
John Bastian will be coming to the show this year for mm-hmm. the first time. John is from the area. He graduated from Conrad Weiser a year behind myself.
Oh, okay. So you were friends, growing mm-hmm. buds.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. And I have a number of John's carvings. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen him in many years, so this will be a treat. Yeah, I know he has a good following, and mm-hmm. it'll be neat to see him okay. at the show again.
Yeah, and we have a few other people here that maybe we can mention quickly.
We have some new folks from New Holland doing the show this year, Ron and Carol Wardell. They do things that you would have seen at Christmas time often in years past. Carol does some feather trees out of goose feathers.
Okay.
And they do some primitive fences that people often use to decorate, make a little farmyard under the Christmas tree. Mm-hmm. They have, I believe they're called bottle brushes, which again is a primitive type of,
yes.
of tree. Tree that was used in that type of mm-hmm. decoration.
Okay. Unfortunately, we have Lynn Summer
She does Frochter. Lynn's been with us for 2 years. Well, we also have Andy Smith, who will be joining us this year. Andy is a painter, does very neat watercolors mm-hmm. That are very traditional. He paints a lot of historic buildings.
Yeah,
and maybe
does.
A view out a window and. Andy always paints and demonstrates when he does a show, and looking forward to seeing him.
Alan Schaefer.
He's
a local.
Yeah, he's from Robinsonia as well. Is an ironmonger.
He does some really cool pieces,
Yeah, he does.
You know, let's see, did we miss anyone
How about
here?
Mike Brown with his paper?
Well, he was in the show, so, yeah.
Bill
you
Miller.
Know,
we...
Bill Miller builds yeah. wonderful furniture.
Fine furniture, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah, he doing the more formal type pieces mm-hmm. with the curly maple and the mahogany and walnut. Mm-hmm. He does some really neat work. So we're glad to have Bill back again.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to think if we have anybody else new this mm-hmm. year. We talked about Wendy and
Jim
Wardell's.
King.
Jim King's been doing the show for a number of years. He does graining on boxes. And picture frames and that type of thing. So
okay, and then the graining is what Wendy does on her frames
That's
too.
Right.
So you know, and so Wendy usually, you know, explains that too very mm-hmm. well in her booth. Mm-hmm. You know, so it'll be, it's such an education to come and talk to the craftspeople
That's
too.
Right.
You know,
mm-hmm.
and everything. It's like. Well, you just want to pass it on, you know.
Sure.
I mean, and that's how Reading Berks is too. You know, when we have the show at Reading Berks, that's how all the craftsmen are. They're very willing to share, and mm-hmm. we invite students, anyone who's interested, you know, to come out to our meetings, even you know. And mm-hmm. craftsmen are always anxious to share.
But just real quickly, I know we're running out of time. The show will be held this year on October 21st. It goes from 10 o'clock in the morning till 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It's at Allegheny Evangelical Lutheran Church, which is in the village of Nowers, at the intersection of 625 and 568 in Brecknock Township.
Yeah, and it says see us on Facebook. How do we do that?
I'm the wrong guy to ask that question.
Okay. Well, there's the little flyer up there for us, and it says, see us on Facebook.
We are on Facebook.
Well, all you have to type in on Facebook is Pennsylvania Traditional.
Traditional Crafts, and
okay.
you'll find it. So.
Right. We're getting better with that.
We are.
Right.
Yeah. So I can't thank you all enough for coming out here, okay?
All
and
right.
We will be back next month with Reading Berks members again, because our show is the Reading Berks mm-hmm. Guild of Craftsmen show is coming up in the beginning of November, so we'll be on TV next month with that. And then let's not forget Oktoberfest. We'll be back on here with a wonderful event of Oktoberfest and having Thursday night craft night. So until then, thank you for joining us, and good night.
Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.